you very much, Cora, and admirable. That's right. I am Frodan. I am wearing this ridiculous outfit, and I am joined by Brian Killer, who looks great as always. How's it going, Brian?
Doing well. I was wondering if we'd actually ever get up here with the interminable match one, but here we are.
The round one that would last a lifetime.
Round 1.5.
Round 1.6, and so forth. But we are jumping to round three, I believe. Or is it round two? I believe this is round two, the end of round two. Some players are in round three. I apologize. I was following some of those updates. Frozen is the player who's bringing the anti-power decks. Bloodyface is playing pretty much the standard straightforward stuff. Token Druid, the Aggressive Shaman, the Zoo Warlock. But Frozen's got that Reno Freeze Mage. He's got that Control Shaman.
I really like Frozen's lineup. It's really interesting. Kind of reminds me a little bit of the lineup we saw from George C. last week. Mm-hmm. That was a very heavily controlling lineup, specifically built to target the aggressive decks that are the most popular.
Yep. Specifically, too, that he's got his own spin on it, too, mm-hmm. that he's got his own Reno Freeze Mage, which has been under heavy criticism after its first tournament win. When it won Seed Story Cup last year at the end of it, when League of Explorers first came out, people started analyzing and just said, why would, like, Reno Jax is just not very good in Freeze Mage because you have to destroy a lot of its consistency, which makes the deck a lot weaker. But this is not the first time that Frozen's brought it to a tournament this year. And Wizards of the Old Gods first came out, and DreamHack, he also brought another Reno Freeze Mage, except that one had Malygos in it.
Well, we will be seeing Shaman from Bloodyface against the Druid deck from Frozen. This is pretty much Frozen's most normal deck in his lineup. The others are the ones that are kind of fancy. So this is a matchup we've seen quite a bit of over the past season or so.
Yep, certainly. This is a matchup that Shaman's starting to get increasingly more powerful in. I was looking at some of the percentages, and it just feels like Aggro Shaman's climbing higher and higher in its win percentages against everything. I think people are really figuring out the refined deck lists. If you choose to play one Lightning Storm, for example, like Bloodyface does choose, it's because you're trying to tech for the metagame. Although some players choose to play Lightning Storm and Flame Juggler and cut maybe the Horse Rider. That's usually the only flexible spots in the deck.
Yeah, one of the strongest openings the Druid is capable of having against the Shaman deck is the Violet Teacher into Power of the Wild, which, if you do not have Lightning Storm in your deck, can be almost impossible to come back from. But the single copy of Lightning Storm is both great there and against Zoo, which is the other matchup, or the real matchup that Shaman tends to really struggle with.
Already a good start to Frozen, having that Living Roots. You know, as Druid passes turns 1 to 3, it's very easy for Shaman to run away with the game. In fact, we're talking to some players, they don't even keep Wild Growth against Shaman. They'd rather have Innervate so they have actual play instead of just letting Shaman build the board freely.
And that Living Roots on turn one allows Frozen to just use his hero power here along with the Treants to remove Tunnel Trog and have no danger of it possibly growing out of control.
Yep, so Bloodyface from here, all of a sudden his momentum stops. He has Tuskar Totemic to put out some minions onto the board. Or Totem Golem, perhaps. Perhaps Totem Golem and Tuskar Totemic.
He does have the coin there, so he could he could play that Tuskar Totemic and get a Totem Golem, much to everyone's chagrin. We were talking a little bit last week about the what is the most unpleasant sound effect in all of Hearthstone. I think it's actually the Totem Golem, not necessarily because the sound effect itself is so bad. I was giving it a moment to give it to
right there.
I had to go for it, you know. But no Totem Golem for the Totemic just there. A Stone Claw, not really going to get too much done.
Ooh.
But Frozen finds Innervate off of Raven Idol, which could let him set up a Violet Teacher this turn or a Mire Keeper. If he did play a Violet Teacher this turn, it would expose it to possible removal by a Flame Tongue or Lightning Bolt or Rockbiter, or even just an abusive Sergeant from Bloodyface. So I imagine he won't go with the Violet Teacher right now. He does. All right, he wants to just go ahead and
attention, class.
Put Bloodyface to the test and at least slow down the damages coming at his face.
Yeah, it's just more stable that way. Ramping with Mire Keeper didn't actually lead to anything specifically for the next turn.
I was actually thinking we might see Mire Keeper into a 2-2 there, just to give him a body that's more resilient to an individual removal effect. Because the Violet Teacher right here means that any damage boost gets rid of the Violet Teacher, doesn't really leave him with all that much in play. He is just going to go ahead and use Lightning Bolt plus the Flame Tongue to take this out with his totem and get 5 damage into the face.
And not exactly what Frozen wants to see. Having the 2-2 token would have been interesting because it would have challenged a lot more. The next turn, he would be at 4 mana as well, so he could still play the teacher. So
play teacher or swipe that turn?
Yeah, play teacher or swipe. Would have been almost in a similar position. I think the upside of having teacher on the board was really high, too. You could start generating 1-1 tokens.
I can't imagine that there's a hand with 5 cards from a shaman at that point that doesn't have one of those cards that removes your Violet Teacher. Then.
Yeah, that's a fair assumption. Frozen now either has the Mire Keeper play, like you mentioned, having the little token out. I don't really like the Feral Rage challenge, and so he does end up summoning the slime. Hopefully this, for him, can challenge the board a little bit more. Buddyface, in the meantime, just has more efficient ways to get onto the board. He can either choose to load up defensive stuff like Feral Spirit to protect it, or he can play Totem Golem and Rockbiter weapons.
Feral Spirit's interesting. It does leave, if he just plays Feral Spirits and attacks the face, he leaves himself pretty vulnerable to a swipe because the opponent could swipe and clear most of his board off with his minions as well. Not super exciting options, though. Totem Golem plus Rockbiter still leaves an opposing 2-2 up that can clear one of his minions. So definitely a number of options for Bloodyface, none of which is obviously particularly attractive.
Yeah, I think, well, I kind of like Feral Spirits just because of the mana efficiency of it and getting it out of the way. What I do like about Totem Gold is that it is a little bit sturdier, but that you don't really want to give away the 5-2 that easily. He chooses to trade into it.
Yeah, and this is in order to protect his Feral Spirits. If he chose to go face, his opponent could get a value trade into one of his Feral Spirits and then potentially lose more or less his entire board to something like a swipe. Or even, you know, lose most of it to just Wrath plus Hero Power. Yeah, it will be the Feral Rage plus Wrath. Just choosing to use his removal sort of mana-wise as efficiently as possible and clear off most of this, leaving the Flame Tongue with just 1 health, which can mean it can be cleaned up by a swipe or just a Hero Power the following turn.
Such as in this instance when Buddyface plays Totem Golem, and then most likely uses Rockbiter just to clear to protect his interests, and then swipe is a clean removal here for Frozen.
Yeah, this is setting up perfectly for what Frozen wants to do in this turn, which is play the swipe, get 2 minions off the board for it, leaving him with a clear board going into, well, it will be an Ancient of War next turn, so great draw for Frozen there. Exactly what he's looking for on his curve.
Yep, precisely there. And then Ancient of War, when your opponent doesn't have many cards or a big board, is actually just one of the ways you can just start turning the game around, locking the Shaman out. The biggest thing that they can play is the Flame Weave Faceless, and Bladeface can't play that end thing from below.
And Bladeface picks up an Abusive Sergeant. Not really super exciting right here. He does have the thing from below, Totem as well. He will be able to clear off the Ancient with most of his resources next turn, thanks to an Abusive Sergeant. He can add up to the magic number 10 with all of those. But again, you know, Frozen still, you know, with big threats in hand and a lot of life to work with.
Yeah, the reason why you would hold on to the Abusive Sergeant instead of playing is because you want to use things like maybe the Totem to trade into smaller targets, if you'd rather use that and keep the thing from below healthier. So Bloodyface now has how much damage?
Well, he has the ability to get through. Yeah, he could use Rockbiter or Abusive plus the thing from below to punch through and kill that Ancient, but doesn't leave him with really much else in terms of offense. I imagine we'll likely see him use the Lightning Bolt because it allows him to save Rockbiter in case he draws Doomhammer to just have that powerful combination available to him next turn or whenever it does come up.
Yeah, that's his last Rockbiter too. He already used the second one.
So now Frozen could play Ragnaros, he has 8 mana, but he's facing a board of 3 small minions, and that's just really not a particularly good situation for Ragnaros. Chooses to go with Emperor instead, which does set him up for the ability to play Ragnaros and use his Hero Power next turn, which makes it much more effective.
Yep, not to mention Emperor by itself is still a very reasonable body.
Absolutely.
In terms of minion stats, 5-5 still challenges almost everything that Bloody has, especially since he used one of the things from below. And now this is what Shaman gets himself into that position where you have so much early game that you still haven't drawn yet. The second Tunnel Drogs, the Argent Squires, the Abusive Sergeants. And then Druid is top ending with so many cards. They have Onyxia, they have Cenarius, they have two Ancients of War. They have Ragnaros. They still have good old friend Yogg-Saron, your friendly neighbor. And it's got a lot of firepower.
I don't know if Yogg's your friendly neighbor. He's more like the crazy neighbor that like is always, you're always worried about something happening. You have to call the cops or something like that.
Oh, man.
All right,
thank
Lava
goodness
burst.
I live in a safer neighborhood. I don't know how it is in Oceanside.
And okay. That does give him removal. Enough damage to clear that Ancient, along with the Rockbiter plus Argent Squire. So he's going to be able to stave off the March of the Ents for a little while. But Frozen still has a very powerful hand. He can actually play his entire hand next turn. Well, not Ooh. Now, you're nourished, but...
That's really good, though, for later on after this turn.
Yeah. He is facing, you know, the three minions in play, so Ragnaros still not looking super hot. Just wants to dig for a little bit more, I think.
Yeah, I don't mind Nourish here. I don't mind Ragnaros. I just like doing anything, pretty much, because it indicates that you're going to win in the long term. Innervate allows him to Nourish out and Innervate.
Yeah, and Bloodyface can see, he recognizes that, you know, he is at such a deficit that Frozen could virtually make random plays for the remainder of the game and very likely come out on top.
And this is just what happens when you can't snowball the early lead. Mm-hmm. And I don't want to kind of chalk it up to something as simple as Frozen getting that Living Roots turn one. It was a lot of things. Like, he was able to innervate out the Violet Teacher. And the whole point is that he was putting pressure off the board because he knew that over time he would win. Mm-hmm. And he would set up certain areas where a swipe would be better. And Bloodyface was trying to account for things like that. But in the end, his hand is very linear. And this is what control players love because, you know, aggressive decks, they do have a very linear plan, but control decks tend to have these a lot of options to try and just wait for the long game. And then in the end, it feels like it's smooth sailing if you can survive that.
Yeah, the real key for the Druid deck there was being able to interact in the sort of early and middle turns. He was able to prevent Bloodyface from getting a large board. And that's really what Druid struggles to deal with, are a significant number of substantial minions in the middle turns of the game. Once it gets late, you start having things like Ancient of War. You can deal with small things, but it's like the Totem Golems and the Feral Spirits and the Flamewreath Faceless. Mm-hmm. You know, that didn't make an appearance, which could have caused him a big problem.
Yeah, absolutely. Druid only can deal with that with through Mulch. So that Druid deck is off the table, leaving Frozen with just his Mage and his Shaman deck, the two more exciting decks in my opinion.
Yeah.
Yeah, I do want to see if the Reno Jackson Freeze Mage can be as consistent. I do know that the Freeze Mage players have started putting every single form of draw back into the deck. Before, they were debating, you know, how many Loot Hoarders do I put? How many Novice Engineers do I put? Am I taking out an Acolyte of Pain? But now they're sticking it all in just because the metagame has accelerated so fast that they really feel like they need every point of draw in. But then, is it still enough draw to make your Reno Jackson activate? Because what if, you know, you have any kind of duplicates in the deck? You need that heal immediately.
Yeah, Freeze Mage is a deck that feels like if it goes to the late game, that it kind of has a great position in most matchups anyway, so do you really, once you get there, do you need this extra bit to push you over the edge?
Yeah.
So, I don't know.
I think so, if you anticipate that the metagame will be super burn heavy, like you do need that, because sometimes even Ice Barrier doesn't save you, and a lot of players, I think, mistakenly cut Ice Barrier, because Ice Barrier is just one of the strongest cards. You know, Freeze Mage is all about buying turns,
right.
And you definitely need that. Just for a little bit of an update, one of the players need to re-log into the client. I think, you know, one of those things where the game says, game recorded. Game recorded, please restart the client. And I think one of them got that notification, so they're immediately trying to re-log back in.
All right, well, let's hope that it goes smoothly this time.
We will, fingers crossed, you know, knock on wood. Pinch some salt over your shoulder, whatever superstitions. Maybe
is that what living with Reyna taught you? Just throw some salt around?
Or maybe just drive down the street and knock on Ben Brode's door. Like, please, Ben, save us. You know, it's a little unfair because I know Ben can't solve all the problems, but it seems like he can.
Like, connections to the internet? I don't think that's in Team 5's purview,
hey Ben, bro,
really.
Can you climb up that pole over there and, like, reconnect all those wires?
Purify this internet connection?
That's right.
There's something wrong with it. We need to fix it.
Yeah. Oh, man. Reconnect the internet. Get 100 down, 100 up, and draw a card. Seems like a really good package deal.
I could use that. I'd play that in my priest.
Imagine. Maybe I'd re-sign up with Comcast. Oh, that's okay. All right, game's starting. Game number two. Remember that this is Conquest format for anybody who's tuning in for the first time. Meaning that you have to win with all of your decks. Bloodyface chooses to pivot to his Druid. Frozen choosing his Control Shaman. I like Control Shaman as a deck a lot. There are some variations that Frozen chose from the list that did get popularized, but the most important card that he has in his deck is the Bot Creeper, in my opinion. And that's the one that he chose to bring.
Yeah, I really like this Control Shaman deck. I think that it matches up very well against really all of the popular decks. It's very solid against sort of all of the big four decks that we've seen in the metagame. Mm-hmm. You know, it's not clear how much that metagame is going to shake up with the release of Karazhan. You know, we do have the week one cards involved here, but we have seen lots of players still on the very, very consistent, predictable lineup that Bloodyface is playing right here, and this deck has worked out very well against it so far.
Certainly. It hasn't gained any tools from Karazhan, I believe, from the first wing. I do believe cards like Maelstrom Portal were tinkered with, but it just wasn't reliable enough. Although, ironically enough, it'd be pretty good against Living Roots.
We're good right here.
Yeah. But the most important thing is that Frozen started loading more card draw on the deck. You see the Ancestral Knowledge. That's a card that a lot of Control Shamans started cutting. Mm-hmm. But he has two of them in his deck because he felt like he needed to have that early game consistency. And instead has taken out some of those more situational removals like Stormcrack, which, while powerful against Totem Golems, not exactly the most consistent card, especially with the overload and the exact damage it provides.
All right, well, the start from Bloodyface here is a little bit aggressive. You know, it does have the Innervate to get out the Mire Creeper. Chooses to ramp his mana. Totally understandably, this is a matchup where he's playing against a lot of area effect removal. And he is going to use the Power of the Wild to power up his team and take down this Doomsayer. So, you know, a very good opening here for Bloodyface at this point.
Yep, the challenge of this is Frozen does not have his Elemental Destruction. That is one of the most important cards in every matchup for the Shaman. And instead, he's still going to draw through the Farsight.
Finds the Hex, and because of the Farsight reduction, he could choose to play that right away, which would halve the damage that he's actually taking each turn if he chose to turn that Mire Creeper into a Frog.
Yeah, I wouldn't mind. Your opponent passed on turn four with just a Power of the Wild, implying that his hand might be setting up for Nourish or setting up for other turn five plays. The best play that you usually have access at turn five, outside of Innervate plays, of course, is that or an Azure Drake. So I wouldn't mind hexing it, just to kind of buy a lot of health.
Chooses to hold on to the Hex. He is facing off it against a deck that has a significant number of large minions in it. But Power of the Wild, another pickup for Bloodyface here. He can push a lot of damage, and that actually puts the Mire Keeper to 5 health, which means that it's not guaranteed to die to Elemental Destruction if it is drawn by Frozen.
Right. It is the second Power of the Wild, implying making his, you know, a lot of his other board loading capabilities weaker. Mm-hmm. But because you're aware of things like Elemental Destruction, it's very rare that 2/2 minions or even 3/3s can survive, no matter how big you build them with Wisps of the Old Gods or Power of the Wild.
In my experience, the Control Shaman matchup is one of the weakest for Druid. There's just so many of the powerful interactions in your deck are based on building a big board of a bunch of relatively small minions. So I like this play from Bloodyface. He's choosing to just go aggressive and force Frozen to have the answer to this board right away. And I think that in a lot of cases, players, you know, they're like, oh, I want to play around this. But in Bloodyface's case, I think he recognizes that, yeah, this is a matchup where I need things to go right for me. So I'm just going to push and try and end the game as quickly as possible.
Okay, so Frozen, I almost certainly feel like he would hex in this position onto the 5/5. I guess what he chooses to do here with the rest of his mana, if he chooses to draw cards with Ancestral Knowledge or Farsight, he has the ability to do both.
Yeah, he does pick up a Lava Shock here, so he can unlock his mana. He doesn't have any way to use that to pair with anything to actually kill anything on the board.
Right. He could also coin Lightning Storm if he needs to remove some of these 3/3s. It's not guaranteed, though. With 3 mana, he still has opportunity to play the Manti, which is just basically draw a card, gain 3 life. And then Farsight number 2, which is not reliable at all. I mean, I don't even know how many cards remain, but there's 20 cards and there's 2 copies. That's not a high chance to hit Elements of Destruction. Okay. Farsight, he looked like he was just kind of undecided, but the rope had to force him to make a decision here.
Does find a Thing from Below. Pretty good minion to get the discount on from Farsight, but not really going to cut it right here. And we see, yeah, Bloody Face picks up a Druid of the Claw and just decides, I'm going to keep with this plan. I'm going aggressive. You have a face, I'm going to hit it.
And Element Destruction is pretty much the last out here, and Frozen doesn't get it. He has to lava shock and then roll high on Lightning Storm.
He needs to get threes on both of these saplings, or he will be facing lethal damage next turn. And
nope.
He sees one of them rolls two, and we are in a tied series, 1-1.
I think you have to kind of go back and wonder about some of the early game plays again. For example, a lot of players really have to debate whether or not they coin out a Doomsayer or not. Mm-hmm. And that always becomes a point of really, like, Doomsayer timing is one of the hardest things about some of these decks, because it's such a real tipping point where it's like, okay, it's like, is it no value here and do I lose my momentum because I used a coin? Or can I get more value off of it to stall another turn and get even more tempo? And it's really, really hard. And in hindsight, obviously, he would have loved to kill that Living Roots, because without that Living Roots and the Power of the Wilds, the damage would have been incredible, and then he would have had to play Power of the Wilds as a 3-2, for example. That would have changed a lot of the game. It's such a hard read to make.
Yeah, he was also just really conservative with that Hex. He chose to hold on to it rather than Hex the 4-4, you know, trying to find a bigger target for it, and just he didn't find the Element of Destruction and just took so much more damage from that minion.
Right.
To Bloody Face's credit, I love the way that he played that game. Yeah. He recognized that he needed to go as aggressive as possible, just put Frozen in a position that he has to find Elemental Destruction right away, and Frozen just didn't, and Bloody Face picked up a win in a tough matchup.
Yeah, and it's also just like an awkward hand. Yeah. Like, he had his really expensive cards from the beginning. His only ramp was Mire Keeper, and even then, he didn't hit anything until he was just basically left. He eventually had no hand, and it was just drawing one card per turn that he could play until turn 7.
Yeah, his hand was just all these expensive things, the Scenarios. Yeah, exactly. That is not a card that's good that matchup.
Right. So you just kind of hope that you can draw at the top there. So if Bloody Face is playing with two less cards in his hand, that's a very difficult position to be in. Being able to sneak out that win, because a lot of times, if you just hesitate for a little bit, like, yeah, you know what? I'll save this for when he plays. Like, because a lot of players, they go halfway. Mm-hmm. They wait for an area effect card like Element Destruction, and then they play another minion onto the board, so that way they stagger their threats. However, that's what ends up making them lose in situations like that.
In particular, in this matchup, you're facing a deck that has tons of big taunts, tons of life gain, other AoE effects, and you need to take the window that you have in the early game when your opponent isn't able to leverage their high mana cards like Bog Creeper. You know, Bog Creeper comes down and so much of your offense is just stopped right there. So you gotta kill them before the Bog Champ takes over.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. Absolutely. Well, it's not game over yet. I believe the Shaman has an even better matchup against the Zoo Warlock than it does against the Druid, because the Zoo Warlock doesn't have actual ways to just directly remove big threats. Druid has Mulch, for example, or Druid has like Raven Idols to help pick them up some stuff. I guess the only thing that I feel like the Zoo Warlock can do against the big taunts is Corruption off of Dark Peddler.
Yeah, they could potentially, you know, obviously build a big board, power overwhelming into it, but the Lightning Storms, I think, are much better against Zoo than they are against Druid. The Lightning Storm's really only good against the small tokens. We even saw in that game, Living Roots got out of range of Lightning Storm.
No.
Where that's just not the sort of thing that typically happens in Zoo games. But it's not Zoo here. It will be Shaman versus Shaman. Very different styles, these two decks, though.
Right, and the Shaman deck is also a pretty good matchup, too, because they don't have access to cards like Hex in their deck lineups, the aggressive Shamans, that is. And that's usually the way you deal with Ancestral Spirit, anything. Big taunts, you can just Hex it and move on with your life, but in this case, you can't. Doomsayer is an absolutely crucial keep here. Frozen still looking for more area of effect. Element of Destruction, also one of those cards.
Do you like to keep Element of Destruction in your opening hand as this deck?
No. I would definitely feel like that's the most important card outside of Doomsayer, too. But sometimes in certain matchups, for example, Dragon Warrior, Doomsayer's not that reliable. They have Execute, they have so many charges from hand. Element of Destruction is much more reliable because it deals with all the health ranges very well up until their 6-mana plays.
Yeah. You're able to deal with the Totem Golems and Feral Spirits all with one card guaranteed, which Lightning Storm, I think, for instance, against Shaman is not necessarily great, whereas Element of Destruction can clear out pretty much everything guaranteed. If you just get the one turn where you blow up their board, it can often be enough, even with taking the next turn off with the overload, to turn the game around.
Now we're back at the exact same question. You're on the coin two games in a row here. Should you actually play this coin Doomsayer? And we know the answer is he doesn't have a reason to based off the hands. But if you're looking at Frozen and you're thinking, what's his best turn two play? It is most likely Totem Golem. What will that force me to do? If I play Stormcrack in that position, that gives him more free development of something else. And then I can't play the Doomsayer. He gets more mana to use it. And he did draw the Totem Golem.
I think against Shaman in particular, getting the Doomsayer out with the coin is the most important, because they're capable of using cards like Flame Tongue Totem and the like to add up the damage to actually take down your Doomsayer, whereas against Druid, they're less likely to be able to assemble a board and burst damage that can kill that early on, so.
Yeah, certainly. This second Doomsayer, you're not exactly that optimistic about
it. It's probably not gonna live.
No, however, given the context of Frozen's hand, he's gonna need to be optimistic in general too, because what this also does is it stops his opponent from playing the Flame Beast Faceless. He has to play a weaker board, and if he draws into Area of Effect cards, then he can be in a pretty decent spot. He has also two things from below, which means over time he can go for these swingy turns. Element of Destruction, one of the hardest parts about it is recovery, but you know that you can play zero mana taunt and you'll be fine.
Well, this is definitely a little bit of an awkward spot for Frozen overall. Bloody Face has a pretty solid board remaining and a lot of options available to him, while Frozen mostly has expensive cards and was just, well, not forced, but ended up using his Stormcrack that will prevent him from playing a 5-drop next turn, which he'd love to do with Earth Elemental.
Yeah, not the end of the world. He has Think from Below for 4 mana. Bloody Face only has a little bit of removal, like Lightning Bolt. I guess that's burn too. It's not necessarily removal. I don't know how much it's I don't know how imperative it is to remove some of these smaller totems. I don't think it's as important. I think rushing your opponent down is even more critical. So after playing Totem Golem, which, you know, again, you kind of have to just hope that your opponent doesn't have things like Element Destruction. Then you just got to go all basic, ignore the totems.
Yeah, the Control Shaman deck doesn't have anything like Defender Vargas or Flame Tongue Totem that can allow totems to be effective tools for board control, like many other Shaman decks typically have. So the only totem that's really particularly problematic is potentially the Spell Power Totem if you're looking to play around AoE, but Bloody Face has a bunch of small minions, so there's no real impact of that additional damage.
Yeah, he's really afraid of Totem Golem getting sniped away.
He finds a Flame Wreath Faceless.
Yeah.
He would love to have had this a little earlier on, where he could have gotten a lot of pressure, because right now, his board isn't getting that much done, but he does have the ability to play the Flame Wreath Faceless and remove the Thing from Below with either his Lightning Bolt or Rock Butter Weapon plus one of the minions. It's interesting whether he chooses to sacrifice his Abusive Sergeant or the Divine Shield on his Argent Horse Rider. If he chooses to use the Horse Rider Shield, obviously he keeps that minion in play, but he is more vulnerable to area effect damage, killing his entire board.
I don't think you're too unhappy if your opponent uses area effect, because that means your Flaming Faceless is most likely to survive.
Yeah, it's true.
Especially if you kill the Spell Power Totem, then they can't use Lava Shock, for example.
Yeah, what he'd be really afraid to see here would be Hex into Lightning Storm, which would clear everything from his board. But Frozen actually has neither of those cards. He just has card draw, healing, and more taunts, which are much less impressive now that there's a 7-7 on the opposing side of the board.
Yeah, and he still doesn't have... I mean, he still can play the Ancestral Spirit onto the Thing from Below. And I think that might be his best play here. It's definitely not the Earth Elemental levels of what you can do, but you gotta stop the pressure.
Yeah, some players might be tempted to try and wait until next turn where they could play Earth Elemental plus the Ancestral Spirit. But Frozen, correctly, I think, recognizing that it's very important that he just stops this incoming damage, that he makes the highest tempo play that he possibly can this turn. And Bloody Face responds with pretty strong tempo play of his own, burning down both copies of Thing from Below and hitting Face for 10 damage.
Frozen still has... Oh my goodness!
Oh, that is a nice draw for Frozen. Whoa. The second copy of Ancestral Spirit puts up a big wall with that double Earth Elemental. So Bloodyface has access to zero copies of Hex, zero copies of Earthshock. He has to go through all 16 health of that before he can get to Frozen's face.
And he can't. The most likely, Earth Elemental survives, which is also a really big deal. Your opponent's going to use things like Lava Burst and going to use other things too. And if you get a read that they don't have any more burn, you can also start healing your minion.
Yeah.
To stop the damage from coming through. Yeah, Healing Wave could heal 14 to your own.
If Bloodyface gets Spell Power Totem, he actually can remove both halves, but he does
He
gets Stone Claw. So this is a huge turnaround for Frozen here, who picked up the best possible card that turn.
And the Control Shaman only needs is one turn, and then all of a sudden the aggressive push is just stopped. You're like, 12 might as well be 30 or 100 if you can't really reach past that taunt. Lava Burst is one of the ways you can get through it, but he's already used that and the Lightning Bolt.
All right, well, Frozen is...
Goodness, that's a huge board. But Frozen just has to find some access to maybe Element's Destruction here.
Finds Lightning Storm, not quite what he's looking for at the moment, I think. He doesn't have the ability to clear nearly enough with that. He does have access to both Healing Wave and Halazeal, so his precarious-looking 12 life will likely turn itself around pretty soon.
Yeah, I do believe that he also fished out both of his Doomsayers. That's actually really huge for Healing Wave, so that means the likelihood of you hitting the 14 is actually pretty high, considering that you have Bog Creepers in the deck as your top end, and Bloodyface already played some of his expensive minions, like Thing from Below, which in the Joust counts as 6. I think Healing Wave here might be his best play. And then save Halazeal Lightning Storm for the following turn to try and answer the board as best as he can.
I'm just going to go ahead and heal his Earth Elemental, like you were saying. He's choosing to preserve his board presence rather than his own face. He knows that there's already been a Lightning Bolt and a Lava Burst cast, so there's no real way for Bloodyface to possibly assemble the burn to kill him, not to mention he only had one card in hand.
Yeah. That's absolutely correct. And Bloodyface picks up Totem Golem, which is not going to help him here. He can get past the Earth Elemental with the Lightning's, the Spell Power Totem.
We see another shake of the head from Bloodyface as he really wanted Spell Power for the second turn in a row and did not find it. So if he wants to get rid of this Earth Elemental, it will take his Totem Golem and that Lava Burst, which is just putting him in a really rough spot.
Yep. The life of a Shaman player in a nutshell. Is it Wrath of Air Totem? Nope. Is it Syrian Totem? Yep. Every single time. And Frozen's going to gain a lot of life this turn. And if he gets a 3 on the Lightning Storm, that's even going to be a full clear. And this comes the comeback of the Control Shaman, if Frozen can lock it out here.
This is the darkest night for Bloodyface, as not quite as bad as it could be.
But still pretty bad. Your opponent just healed for 10 life.
Also, you have no cards in hand, and your opponent has a minion bigger than anything you do on board. That's like the one time you're not that upset a Totem Golem comes down, because you know this game is virtually locked up already. Frozen has card draw to find more removal, as well as other big taunts. So he's in a really good spot right here.
Woo!
There's another Lightning Storm.
Oh, man.
So he has Zone Shot at a Spell Power Totem if he decides to take it for that Lightning Storm.
That is a clear if you Hex and Lightning Storm, but you don't have to. You
just,
most likely clear it anyways.
Attack into the Totem Golem as well.
Sure.
If he hits 3, he can kill it with his Searing Totem. If he doesn't, he can just kill it with the Halazeal anyway. So
he does.
And here we are, full health with a Halazeal, and Bloodyface knows this is not a game he is going to win. Just goes ahead and concedes.
I'm liking it, man. I do have a fondness for this deck. I think it's fantastic and extremely underrated in the metagame. I think a lot of people felt that it was just a surprise factor, but it's also just really solid. And you can see that Frozen had an advantage just by the fear, too. Remember that Bloodyface chose to play around certain area effect cards for a long time. He didn't play that Totem Golem for multiple turns, and in the end, he was off by certain damage points. You know, what if he was able to play that, get a little bit aggressive, and then use his burn to jump over his opponent as opposed and finish the game as opposed to go through his minions. It's something. It's food for thought for sure. Yeah, like, you're never sure if that's the case.
But I definitely also think that Blayface navigated that very well, choosing to play his Ancestral Spirit on the Thing from Below, despite having the Earth Elemental still in his hand, recognizing what matters is getting the best possible board right now.
Yep.
He can't try and play for a long game if he doesn't, he could just die and there is no long game.
Right, and he did end up drawing the other Ancestral Spirit, which was huge in that position. But he also had a fallback plan, because remember he had that Hollow Zeal also in his hand in case he was able to get Lightning Storm and Elemental Destruction. It would have also been equally big.
Well, we are into game number four here. Frozen leads 2-1, has just his Reno Freeze Mage deck left to win with. Bloody Face with the nemesis of Freeze Mage in Aggro Shaman. I do think this is one of the matchups where Reno can be pretty huge, though.
Yeah, Reno can be massive in this. I do feel like Ice Barrier is even more important in the early stage of the game. You might even keep that. And another thing, too, is that the Shaman deck, according to some expert Freeze Mage players, it's not my opinion, but they think this matchup is even. Like,
really?
Dead on 50-50. Because a lot of people play this matchup with fear. Mm-hmm. They feel that the aggressive Shaman just, you know, they have so much early game ability to put up pressure and you can't stop it. But the chances of drawing Doomsayer if you fish extremely hard for it is close to 50%. If you go second, it's you know, definitely there. If you're going first, it's a little bit less, but you do have the advantage of having more mana. And that's why they put two Noz Engineers and two Loot Hoarders and all this stuff. So if Frozen is extremely proficient with Freeze Mage, which I do consider him to be, this matchup might go the other way if you keep your eyes closed.
Well, this is a pretty good start for Bloody Face, though. There's no Doomsayer for Frozen just yet. Well, I spoke too soon. There's a Doomsayer for Frozen.
Yes.
But this is a matchup where it's very important that you could potentially play that in turn one, because there's so much ability for the Shaman to generate additional board presence and force you to pair the Doomsayer with a Frost Nova. And when you do that, not only do they have Burn that can potentially kill it, but can often just finish you off with Burn because you weren't able to stop their early aggression.
So the Forgotten Torch, removing 3 damage, 6 onto the board. Blayface has Totem Golem. Sir Finley getting the 100 hero power is also pretty big, too. I think Blayface recognizes the turn for Frost Nova Doomsayer, so perhaps you do want to fish for that hero power.
Who's up for an adventure?
And if you don't get this, Druid is also good, too.
Steady Shot.
Steady Shot is the best by a big margin. I would be very surprised if you picked Life Tap.
One of the keys with Steady Shot here, not only do you obviously love doing damage to your opponent's face when you're playing Aggro Shaman, but it's damage that gets around any sort of freeze effects. So you can kill your opponent despite the fact they may be able to freeze your entire board. It's obviously also great if you're able to pop your opponent's ice block at one. And yeah, this is just a lot of damage very fast. Frozen already down to just, well, he's actually even going to go ahead and rock bite to the face. It's down to just 7 life. So there is lethal represented in any number of ways next turn.
Yeah, Frozen doesn't have much of a choice. Chooses Frost Nova Doomsayer. And Bloody Face has 2 mana remaining after. So even okay, no, he doesn't have that ability. He played so fast as if he drew the lethal, but he does not have it. And Frozen has 11 duplicates in his mage deck, even willing to play 2 Ice Spears, which I think a lot of players cut. I don't really agree with that when they cut it. It's definitely one of the better cards in the deck.
So by doing this, Bloody Face set himself up to ensure that he could break Ice Block with the hero power, even if his opponent Ice Lanced his face. So here he's just going to go ahead and fire away. It may seem a little bit weird that he's just choosing to play the Rock Biters on his face when it's not going for lethal, but it specifically sets up forcing Frozen to have block into block to have any chance of staying alive.
And that's not going to do it. So Frozen gets overwhelmed. And while that was quite the one-sided stomp, I think the game would have been very different if he got that Doomsayer a turn earlier.
Yeah.
And then he would have to play a little bit more honestly. Now, the game wouldn't have gone the Freeze Mage's way guaranteed if he drew a single Doomhammer. Those 2 Rockbiters would be incredibly potent.
Oh, absolutely.
But with that hand from Frozen, he had the Alexstrasza already in hand. Reno Jackson is not actually a card you didn't want to draw early. You maybe want to draw it past the halfway point of your deck because then you have more consistency of when it activates. But he also had more stalls. So I do believe that outside of that early game, incredible hand from Bloody Fist, that it could have gone the other way as well.
Absolutely. I mean, we've seen Freeze Mage defeat Shaman just in the last couple of weeks. We saw George C navigate a matchup very well where he was able to defeat Aggro Shaman with his Freeze Mage deck. So certainly a matchup that can go either way, though we've mostly tended to see it go in favor of the Shaman.
If Bloody Fist lost that game, by the way, Aggro Shaman would have lost three games that series. It would have been the reason he lost all three games being targeted.
All right, well, it will be Zoo versus Freeze Mage. This is a classic in Hearthstone. Has shifted in terms of the exact dynamics of how it works, but still tends to be in favor of the Freeze Mage.
Yeah, pretty dramatically, in fact. This is one of the biggest attributes that Freeze Mage brings to a lineup is that Zoo Warlock is one of the most popular decks in the entire tournament, in the entire metagame, in the entire history of Hearthstone.
Yeah.
And Freeze Mage has had a very large edge over it. Bloody Face does have a single tech against it with a Crazed Alchemist. But, you know, the chances of your opponent having the Doomsayer again are not very high. And Frozen this time doesn't have the coin, which is pretty valuable. So Bloody Face is going to just look to get onto the board as fast as possible and then have to play around some of these harder turns of do I go more aggressive on the board or do I play around his freezes?
And Frozen does not have any of the early plays so far. No Novice Engineer, does not have any of the other Loot Hoarder sort of cycle effects. He does have Arcane Intellect he could potentially use to get the card draw engine going next turn. Bloody Face off to a reasonable opening himself with Darkshire Councilman. That is a minion that can put up a lot of pressure very quickly on the Freeze Mage.
Definitely. Darkshire Councilman feels rather innocuous at first, but it starts getting very threatening later on. We'd like to see the card draw mechanisms this turn, Acolyte or Arcane Intellect, had validity. Don't really think Ice Barrier is needed there. You can start playing your secrets after you start freezing and being more secure.
Crazed Alchemist is kind of an amusing card that Bloody Face just picked up. He could go ahead and swap his councilman or swap the opposing acolyte. Does just decide to go ahead and trade in with his, what is it, demon beast? I forget what it's called. Shadow beast. That's what it is. And Frozen to just get a single card off of his acolyte. Then Frozen pulls the trigger on Fireball, taking down the councilman.
One thing to consider is in this matchup specifically, which, by the way, I got to talk to Laughing a little bit, and he gave me some coaching on this matchup. He says this matchup is trivial. Like, Freeze Mage shouldn't even really consider a real matchup because it's that favored. But that, you know, and then I know every player who specializes in the deck tends to lopside their matchups in terms of their own bias. But a large reason why is because if you remove the minions and you just spend it efficiently, what you essentially do is you're killing the Warlock by burning their minions because they're going to life tap their resources. So things like Alexstrasza are not nearly as important, because a lot of people always think about Alexstrasza into the burn, but if you just keep burning the minions and you just be very efficient with it, then you should be able to drain your opponent's life to the point where you can kill them anyways.
And Bloody Face does have that Crazed Alchemist to deal with this Doomsayer away, so if there is, you know, a game where maybe this isn't quite as trivial, he's able to push for a lot of damage. There is the Blizzard waiting in Frozen's hand that will clear up pretty much everything, even if Crazed Alchemist does take this Doomsayer down. Bloody Face also has the option to just play the Defender Vargas, which is what he's going to do. And I like this play a lot. It might seem very attractive to play your Crazed Alchemist. It's like, oh, you have a Doomsayer. I can play a Crazed Alchemist. But this both removes the Crazed Alchemist and ensures his board against Blizzard. Blizzard will still leave him with four minions in the board. Five minions in the board because of the Shadow Beast as well, which I now remember the name of.
Yep, and that actually complicates Frozen's plans a lot. Before he was kind of going on this Blizzard plan, might end up having to change it. I don't know, it's still a lot of damage to take if you just play Torch and Ice Barrier. It's almost negated, so perhaps Blizzard is still the choice. They have chosen to cut Flame Strike, I believe, from the deck from Frozen. So he doesn't have access to as much area effect cards as he used to have. I think a lot of Freeze Mages in general just don't like Flame Strike as much as they used to.
Yeah, generally a lot of Freeze Mage decks these days have aimed to play less of a control game and more of a outpace you and just combo burn you to death game. Trying to set up for the ability to just kill their opponent instead of trying to actually exhaust their resources with something like Flamestorm. And it will just, yeah, Torch into Barrier decides that he wants to try and milk this Blizzard to clean up more of his opponent's future turns. Oh, and, well, there is a pretty powerful card from Bloody Face. Can get down that Doom Guard, and suddenly...
But it does discard the Crazed Alchemist in a very odd way. It makes the Doomsayer much better. Frozen sees that being discarded. He gets that Frost Nova, he insta-slams it.
He just knows
that there's no way for Bloody Face to deal with it. So in a lot of ways, Bloody Face is presented with an awkward situation.
Yeah, absolutely.
So you have to think, though. What are the higher chances of happening? What are the chances that your opponent picks up the second Doomsayer and have a freeze to chain on it?
It's also worth thinking about, you know, right here, how much pressure does this Doomguard really give you? How much does this change the game? You know, if I Doomguard here, does the dynamic of my clock change against what I can expect you to play? And it looks like Bloody Face debates it for a while. And yeah, we see the Crazed Alchemist, a little bit of a nod from Frozen as that ends up getting discarded. And
yeah,
Bloody Face
really
is thinking, okay, I'm just trying to set up lethal in a turn.
Oh, there it is.
Frost Nova off the top, setting up the perfect answer for Frozen here.
Yeah, and if Frozen was not accounting, or sorry, if Bloody Face is not accounting for the Frost Nova Doomsayer, I don't blame him at all. This is extremely unlikely based off the last two draws of what Frozen was able to get.
And look at that reaction. Yeah, not happy about that at all. And Bloody Face picks up a Defender of Argus. That doesn't do anything for him here. Just going to have to watch as this entire board is wiped out. Frozen at just 12 life.
Wow.
But now this is where Freeze Mage gets in the driver's seat.
Absolutely. Picking up Ice Block, a huge pickup as well, so that way he doesn't have to worry too much about his life. We've seen a lot of duplicate copies, by the way. I think we're missing a Novice Engineer, and we're missing a Frostbolt.
We've seen no copies of Frostbolt, yeah.
Yeah, so I believe 2 is the number in Frozen's hand, because if you also get to play Reno Jackson, that might feel like a lockout turn as well. Forbidden Ritual, one of the ways you can get back onto the board. Bloody Face, a little bit afraid of things like Blizzard. He can play Forbidden Ritual first, bait out that Blizzard, and then play some of his other minions that are vulnerable as well.
We'll just go ahead and fill the board up, but a Emperor for Frozen here, which I expect we might just see him play as a minion to the board. This isn't a matchup where he needs to set up any kind of big combo with the Emperor, not looking for a one-turn kill or anything like that. I might expect him to see him attack with a Loot Hoarder into one of these tokens, see what he picks up, get another card discounted from the Emperor as well.
I don't dislike playing Blizzard this turn.
It's totally reasonable as well.
Yeah, you do kill off the board, and you force your opponent to play other stuff. I guess the follow-up on it is really weak. You only have Emperor and Reno afterwards.
I think if he clears off one of these, he's going to go ahead and Blizzard and just get some damage in with the Loot Hoarder, which also matters in this matchup. The fact that your opponent is life-tapping makes your just burn you to death win condition more relevant. He's already played one copy of Fireball, so his ability to assemble lethal burn damage is lower than it would be otherwise.
With Forgotten Torches in the deck, too, I don't feel like he's worried about that just yet. Sometimes it does end up becoming an extreme grind fest, but it's very rare. So Bloody Face just doing his best, playing his Flame, sees that the Blizzard was baited out successfully, and now Frozen has to respond. Second Fireball, not a bad draw. He can also pick up another card here, Loot Hoarder. All right, not the worst situation.
And he's going to go ahead and use the Ice Lance to protect that Emperor, forcing his opponent to attack in with multiple smaller minions, not get any payback on it if he wants to remove it. Ardent Squire, not super exciting for Bloody Face.
Ooh, Sea Giant
is a pretty nice draw here. It's actually, Frozen is kind of out of gas. He has 2 cards in hand. None of them draw cards. He does have the Thalnos in play, which can dig him a little bit deeper. But right now doesn't have great ways to necessarily deal with a big minion from Bloody Face.
Yeah, it is interesting that Frozen chose to use the Ice Lance to stall so that way he can get Emperor and the Thanos onto the board. I totally understand why Thanos is on the board. You want to get the card draw. It does feel like if you're going to be in that position, you want to also have the burn to finish the game. However, he only had Fireball. He does have one of the torches in his deck, too. So those are some of the damage sources. He doesn't have Pyroblast, for example. Pyroblast would be a way that you could just feel like he guarantees the inevitable win.
Yeah, Bloodyface does have... He's way to actually crack the block. So I don't know if it's worth attacking face. I think he probably wants to go ahead and take care of the Emperor here. And that's exactly what he does. Yeah, just going to go ahead and clear up the board, leaving himself with enough damage on board. Oh, there is Frostbolt, so Novice Engineer, Novice Engineer. I believe this turns on Reno.
Yeah.
I'm colorblind, so I can never tell when he's activated. But
oh, that's awkward.
Is he? I really can't tell.
No, it is.
Okay, active. Good. I thought we were tracking right, but...
Yeah. Yeah, I also like that Frozen was thinking about using Emperor potentially as damage to his opponent as well. Mm-hmm. It's also something to think about. He's got 9 damage in the hand. If he plays Reno, it just dies to the Sea Giant.
So yeah, he's gonna go ahead and Frostbolt.
Remember, if you start stalling the game, your opponent wants the life tap, so he's burning himself at the same time, and Frozen's trying to get to that point where he can buy extra turns.
Well, Bladeface does have the ability if he draws Abusive Sergeant to break with Power Overwhelming.
Yep.
Does not pick it up.
Or
so.
Direwolf Alpha, yep. Or mm-hmm. even a Dark Iron Dwarf. It's close, but no cigar.
Yeah. Frozen down to 6,
so scary,
but there
too.
Is that Reno.
A defensive Alexstrasza is also a possibility.
Yeah, that's got to be kind of attractive here because it does also just give him an 8-8 on the board.
Let's see, 8, 10, 15, 16 power on the board. But like you said, he has to choose between clearing the Alexstrasza and doing it. Perhaps just playing Reno Jackson then is better. You could also draw with Loot Hoarder first.
It's a little bit awkward because it is the Imp Gang boss on the opposing side of the board. Yeah, this is definitely kind of a tough spot because opponent's at pretty low life, but he only has the one Fireball. He's going to go ahead and fire. Oh, no, he is debating.
But Fireballing allows you to get 3 damage direct to your opponent with the minions.
It looks like he is going to do that. Fireball takes out the Imp Gang boss, and Reno Jackson will restore him up to full life.
Ooh. Bag of gold.
In fact, rich.
Turns out it's actually a bag of 24 life, and Bloodyface shaking his head, because now Frozen's bought a lot of time. And let's see if Bloodyface trying to figure out like how much damage he actually needs. He's got 8, 10, 13, 17 damage. It's definitely not enough.
Oh, there's the Direwolf Alpha that would have popped the block last turn, but unfortunately that block is now very far away from getting broken. And now Bloodyface needs to play defense. He's down to just 12 life.
Right. And his hero power feels effectively useless. Now, if you have the opportunity to get Sir Finley Murgleton off a Dark Peddler, maybe you consider getting it. But
all right, let's start armoring up. Yeah. Changed my mind. Don't want to be a Warlock anymore. I'm renouncing darkness.
There you go. Purified again. Second ice block is useful. Remember, Frozen has more burn. I believe he has another Frostbolt and Ice Lance. He also has the Roaring Torches. All viable options, and his opponent's getting closer to that death point.
All right, well, Bloodyface, kind of the control deck now, choosing to clear the board and just get some damage in. Frozen in kind of an amusing spot. He could play his Alexstrasza, but has to heal his opponent to do so. He can't easily clear the Sea Giant either. You know, he is short on burn. That second ice block was probably the worst draw in his deck for him, since it doesn't actually do anything at this point. And he, you know, can't easily clear the big threat that Bloodyface has in play and productively do anything else either.
I believe you still want to hero power the face, because with ice block you get another damage. Ice block could be translated to 1 damage because you get the hero power the next turn.
That's true.
If you're basically trying to fish for Roaring Torch, and with Roaring Torch and Frostbolt, the hero power, that's 10 damage. Mm-hmm. And if you get to put him down 11, that means you have the exact clock. You have to be worried about what ways your opponent can pop your ice block prematurely relative to the amount of cards you have in your deck. There's not enough cards drawn that I think Frozen has less than 5 cards remaining in his deck. He actually has like a decent amount visually, and usually when it's very thin, it's like
like four or less.
He will out charge himself. So here he does cost himself some life, but he is putting that big 8-8 in play as a threat that Bloodyface has to deal with, or else it represents lethal. He's hoping that he can get the Sea Giant off the board, trading into the Alexstrasza, but the abusive Sergeant Draw here looks like Bloodyface can now remove the Alexstrasza and just continue pushing damage to face. He can't quite kill it and break block, I think, right? And he's certainly far from doing that. Do 4, 5, 6. Abusive Sergeant actually doesn't significantly change. Well, it allows him to kill the Alexstrasza without having to trade off his Giant, which is huge.
Yeah, he can just use the Imp and the Argent Squire. 2, 3, 5, 12. He's one off. He's one off from killing Alex and popping the ice block. Because everything slides in. You buff the Argent Squire. 4 goes into Alex. 2 goes into Alex again.
But he's still pretty far from being able to actually break the ice block as well, right? He can only actually get the 11 in here. Well, he can attack with both these, and then trade the Direwolf off. Yeah. So he.
Yeah.
Is able to put Frozen down to just 3. All right, Frost Nova represents another turn, as you mentioned, which represents one damage from ping.
Yeah, I was counting the Abuse Sergeant, the attack as well, but he's still off regardless, and now Frozen's just on the stall plan. Now he knows that it's a Doomguard draw from Bloodyface. 8 cards remaining. Frozen has 7 cards. So over the next 2 turns, he needs to draw one of his Roaring Torches. And Bloodyface doesn't have, he has a tap here in this position. That makes it even worse.
Yeah, Power of Omi doesn't do anything. So
Ice Lance becomes another opportunity for Frozen to end the game. So that's 2 draws out of 7 here.
And he finds Novice Engineer, which
three
is another
draws
draw.
Out of 7.
You like my invention.
And it finds him Mirror Image, which buys some more time. Doesn't really protect his block meaningfully, though. Mirror Image can't stop the block from being broken this turn, so I imagine he may likely just hold on to it.
Well, it can if he Frostbolts the Giant, which
sure.
I don't feel like you need to. It's hard to say, because if you keep the Frostbolt, that means Ice Lance becomes active, and if you just Hero Power the face.
Yeah, I think Frozen just wants to Hero Power face this turn. Mirror Image doesn't do anything to protect his block. He has another block for the following turn.
What Mirror Image Frostbolt Hero Power does is potentially get Nov's Engineer damage in, so you still have 2
it's
there.
True.
But then the Ice Lance becomes inactive, I believe. Or did he use both Ice Lances? And we're misremembering.
He used one Ice Lance earlier. He Ice Lanced the Imp Gang boss earlier to prevent. And he is going to hold on to the Mirror Image and his burn. There's a Doom Guard, so.
Too late, though.
Yeah, that's not really relevant now. So Bloodyface is going to pop the block, but there is another block waiting in the wings, and Frozen just needs to find Roaring Torch or Ice Lance at this point, because he is in range to just finish the game off with that Frostbolt. There it is. And Frozen navigates tough situation and finds himself exact lethal damage.
It's the rewarding aspect of it. He also had another turn, but, you know, it's a job well done for Frozen, as he is going to move on to round 3. Once again, targeting this exact lineup. He brought a Control Shaman, he brought a Freeze Mage, he brought this very defensive, slow version of the Token Druid, and he's specifically trying to shut out this aggressive lineup, and he's successful thus far, and I wish the best for him.
Yeah,
he's not even my pick.
I really do like his lineup quite a bit, and really love to see people who make interesting lineup decisions and deck building decisions get rewarded.
Absolutely. So that's it for us. We're going to head over to TJ in the Blackboard for some updates on what's happening around the preliminary.
Thanks very much, guys. That's right. I'm TJ, and this is my Blackboard. And also, that's Admirable is joining me as well to help me out with the update segment. Now, first of all, what an exciting match. There were some different plays that we had some different lines on, but overall, pretty high-level play across the series.
Yeah, a very debatable series in terms of what lines are going to be superior, but keeping a cool head and being very calm and collected as you're playing these matches, it's paramount to your success because there's a lot of play to go.
Yeah, a lot of play to go, and a lot of players still left remaining, still over 130. Keep in mind, guys, we started with 168 players, so we're starting to narrow it down, but this is a very big tournament. It's a marathon for a lot of these players, especially especially ones that fall down to the lower bracket early on. You can see there, Bradford Lee, a participant in the America Spring Championship last year, has been eliminated.
Yeah, every player with a red slash through their name has been knocked out of the tournament so far. It's double elimination, so two losses and you're done.
That's right. Fairfax still going strong. Pizza is the only player to be eliminated from the Fairfax location.
Got eaten really quick.
He did. He did. Lots of hungry players there. Hungry for wins, that is. And Toronto as well. Still a lot of players going strong. Dacian Wolf, who's a player that practices with many players that we've seen make it to championships, he's been eliminated, but some of his practice partners probably still going strong.
Yep, and then you can see there is Latin America. Still a lot of representatives left. But not
the two that have been to championships so far with PNC and Snail.
That is absolutely correct. You know, it's tough to make it back to a back-to-back championship or even two of them in a single season in general. That's Hearthstone for you.
Indeed. And, of course, the Tavern Heroes, lots of them still remaining. Probably the strongest group of Tavern Heroes we've seen, including players like Durat, Dart, and Chinulan, but she has been eliminated from the tournament. Some more updates across the board. Impact has taken out Purple and thus eliminated him from the preliminary, 3-0. And we were trying to get some updates before. We think Impact losses next year is 0-3. We'll get that checked up on you. But if you're an Impact fan, he's in the lower bracket at the moment, at the very least. And, of course, K-Felt taking the win over Chestdude. Chestdude not doing too well.
Yeah, I mean, that's a big one for Chestdude here if he was going to find himself a second performance as well. But, you know, sort of the nature of these is consistency is going to tell the big story. So I guess at this point for Chestdude, it's left to next year.
Indeed. And Astrogation has taken out Fibonacci. Fibonacci picked from Frodan early on because of his bizarre decks. Pretty cool decks, but weird nonetheless. And Astrogation still going strong. He's a player that's been around for a long time and going strong in the winner's bracket. And, of course, Chalky taking out the Rat. Two pretty good friends, probably disappointed they had to face each other early on, but Chalky's going strong.
Yeah, a little bit about Astrogation, kind of touch on that a little bit more. In the spring and winter preliminaries, he did not have very strong performances, but since then it's been looking like it's great for him. He's like 3-0 so far in this bracket, and this could be his tournament. I know he's been putting in a lot of hard work and had a lot of top eights and open cups. Maybe now he can find a big win.
Yeah, he's also had, like you mentioned, some success in qualifying for some tournaments, and definitely a player that's on the rise, a player to look out for. Chalky also, we talked about earlier, but even more so than the stakes of making it to another championship for him, is right now he's right outside of that last call.
Yes.
Which means that he needs to do well at this tournament to try and secure more points to make it there.
Yeah, he's kind of got two chances, in effect, where if he manages to win the summer championship, he's automatically in BlizzCon, but if he just performs well in general, that's still something that can get him that BlizzCon ticket. He's so close to securing himself a top eight spot. This tournament is super important for him.
Mm-hmm. And we'll check up on the predictions later, but we are ready for our next match of the day, so let's send it over to the desk.